I'd like to offer these applauses to the Lord. He's the one being glorified here tonight and always. And also, I'd like to thank Mary, Alexander, and Paul for being so kind and always inviting me to come and share with you all these different times that I've been able to share with you. And tonight, especially, we will say that this is a very, very important moment for us when we're talking about getting together and tuning ourselves in with the heartbeat of the Lord. We're talking about the Sacred Heart and the Immaculate Heart of Our Lady, and talking about victim souls. This is Major League. We're talking about transcendental decisions in life. We're talking about understanding the real mystery of life and the real mystery of Christianity. Because the days we are living today are days that are demanding much more than they ever been before. And we have talked about this many, 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 many times. And those of us that have been lately, especially, so deep into trying to find out what the Lord is saying and what the Lord is signaling, what heaven is showing us every day, then we know that something is taking place where our church is aching. When you see that there are no seminarians, there are no priests being consecrated. I just went to a Windsor to give a talk, my second time there, and we know they are closing 3 churches there because there are no priests. And when you talk about that, you talk about serious situations where we are responsible to think about who are we and what are we all doing about this. We could say that the priests have a lot to do with this, but you know, that wouldn't be fair. I think we all have to do with this. And the reason why there are no vocations is because we are not committed. So our church is falling behind the battle. And the battle of the devil is getting so hard and so difficult to compete and so difficult to defeat, because our weapons are falling behind. We are getting weaker. We don't have the battles. We don't have the weapons. And we are not using them. That's what it is. So tonight, I would suggest that we all know we are here because we are not exactly those that are away from God. We are where we can call God's people. And we are very proud to say that, because we love our Lord, and we are here because we love Him. And we are here because we believe in Him, and we are here because we feel the Holy Spirit flowing through us. And we know that Jesus is alive, that our Virgin Mary is not a dream, that she is alive and present in our lives, present in our hearts. That is a reality that we wake up and there is an angel standing right beside us. That is a reality that we walk through the streets and there are devils around us. We all know this, and we accepted this as a reality. We accept that what is not to be seen is what is ruling, and what is seen is what is depending on what is not seen. And that's a reality that as Christians we have to take. And it's difficult, because that's where the victim soul starts. Where do a victim soul start? Where the soul realizes that our enemy is invisible. That is the moment when we become a victim soul. Because then we realize what we're facing. We are facing the invisible. How do we fight the invisible? Are we going to be able to do this? And do we really know that we have weapons, and do we really know that we can use them? And do we really know that they were given to us to use them? And do we really know how responsible we are when we talk about being Christians and talk about having sacraments and talk about taking Jesus to everyone's heart, starting by our heart, taking it for real, taking it not for granted, but taking it for real? Then what we say is finding out that we are standing within a spiritual realm in this life, even though we are in this material world, separated from the sight of the Spirit. We can't see our spiritual surroundings. We cannot see them. We know that we are in this body that is deaf, mute, and blind to the Spirit. But then our challenge as Christians is to realize how powerful is the gift of our Lord, the Sacred Heart of Jesus, that when we let it beat within us, and let that heartbeat of Jesus be our heartbeat, and take this human heart and put it in His hands, and put it right at the cross, and tell Him, I know if I beat with this human heart, I'm just going to beat to death. But if I beat with your holy and sacred heart, I'm going to beat to live. And I'm going to be palpitating to eternity. When we are set up in a human heartbeat, we are only set up to a heart attack. That's all, the only thing we're going to get. We're going to just die with it. One day it's going to stop. And it's going to stop right dry on our tracks. And maybe we're going to be standing in nothing, in the dark. But the call to the victim souls, the biggest call, the saints. What are the saints? Victim souls. Those are the saints. The saints gave everything to the Lord because they found out the enemy was the world. The enemy was the flesh. We are sin. And the only thing good that we have is God. But everything else is bad. So if we realize that, then we start understanding victim soul. We start understanding suffering. We start understanding the cross, pain, and reparation. How important it is to realize that our life, this life that is given to us as a grace, as a blessing, even though it's given to us in such a mysterious way, because we wonder, how could we get a grace when we are given a body that is damned, a body that is condemned not only to die, but is also in the presence of evil permanently through the flesh, because it's the product of evil, the product of original sin. And these questions come to mind, but let them get to your heart. They come to your mind, but don't let them come to your heart. Because if you let those questions come to your heart, that's when you start running away from God, questioning the Creator. We are saying, if we do know that the world is just a passing circumstance of our life, our eternal walk into the Lord, and we start realizing that the more we understand that this is going to die any moment, this body, and this world is going to pass any moment, the more we understand the duty, the Christian duty that we are called upon through Jesus Christ. And it is to be Christ and to be the victim soul, the suffering soul, the one that takes upon himself or herself the duties of suffering with love, and offer every single step of your life, every single temptation, every single difficult moment, and every single beautiful moment in this life, and give it all to the Lord, and know always that none of this is given to you by anyone else but God, including the bad, because He uses that for salvation. This is the biggest test of the soul, to understand that we are put on the fire, and then we are there in this fire, and we are being just molded by the Lord or burned by the devil. So within this fire that we are living in, this fire of love or this fire of hatred, is where we are going to become what we are going to become. Talking about Jesus, talking about the Sacred Heart of Jesus, talking about the miracle of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, our channel direct to Jesus, our gate to heaven. And we are saying, when we say we are in an alliance of the two hearts, we are talking about salvation, the perfect door to salvation. Let's pick any saint that you can dream about, any saint that you know or that you heard about, any one of them, and you will only see a victim soul in each one of them. Let's take any instant of your life when you stop dry because you reacted with love and didn't attack someone that attacked you. A moment when somebody humiliated you and was really hard with you and did so many horrible things to you, and somehow you received this incredible grace and you didn't react with hatred and you just loved back and you gave it back the way Jesus asked us to give it back, with love, even though we received such a blow of hatred and such a blow of horrible attitudes that human give sometimes, and we do give sometimes to our brothers when we don't like what is happening, what is taking place, when the outcome is not expected the way we are expecting it. And then we say this: if we realize that we have been victim souls from time to time, and we realize that between those time to times, victim souls that we've been once in a while, we wasted all the other time that we weren't, and we wasted it not only for our salvation, but we wasted it for the salvation of so many souls around us, like the family, the ones we love, our kids if we do have them, our parents if we do have them, everyone around us, starting with the family and going with the world, with humanity, because we are a single body in Christ, and we know this. We understand this. We are here tonight because we are faithful to the Lord, and we are not new here. We have been here in front of Jesus. We have been here talking to Jesus before. We have been here recognizing that we are sinners. It's not the first time we are here telling the Lord, I'm sorry, Lord, forgive me. And it's not the first time that we know and understand that we need to confess and we need to repent and repair and go on with our lives and start all over again, time after time, time after time. And it's painful and it's terrible to carry these sins with us and know that we're going to fall again. And know that we are facing sin. That's what we're facing every day. And that alone makes us a victim soul if we understand that that's where we are, what we are made of. Because understanding that this is sin and we're going to be living in sin until we depart, then that is understanding the victim's soul. But if we do it with love, if we accept this sinning life with love and say, I am weak, I am nothing without the Lord, and every time I step out of the light and go into the dark, I fall and I feel the pain. Because the more I love Jesus, the closer I get to God, the more I understand my mother, my holy mother, the more it hurts every time I fall. Every time I betray the grace that the Lord gave us, it's more and more painful. That's getting us closer to the truth. Because the more it hurts to sin, the closer we are to love. Then, at that moment, the Lord is getting so incredibly large in us, is growing so much, because the more we feel that pain, that suffering by sinning, and that suffering of seeing sinners around us, the more we are loving God. And that is what we are called to do: understand suffering as love, understand pain as salvation, and then walking into the mystery of the cross. Because at that moment, what we're doing is we're taking this realization that I feel really terrible when I see my brothers doing these horrible sins and living a life of sin. And more horrible even when I am the one sinning and find myself in such a treacherous way, betraying the faith and betraying the glory that we were living just a few minutes before sin. Then at that moment, the Lord tells us, remember me. And remember Calvary. Every time we are sitting at the throne of poise with sin, we have to remember Calvary. We are sitting there in this kingdom of sin because we decided to sin just because it's convenient for us. It's the way to take advantage of the moment, the way to take advantage of our weakness, the way to take advantage of everything that is bringing us into a human heart, everything that separates us from God, which is so many moments of our life. We are close to fall and fall and fall many times. Not only close, but we do fall. And then those times are the times when we are not looking at Calvary, when we are not looking at Jesus in the cross, the message that he gave us forever. And how many times we come here and we see all of this. We see Jesus everywhere showing us the way. showing us the truth, showing us exactly what we have to do, this work through Calvary, the passion, the cross, showing us the bread and the way to salvation, showing us the spiritual food. And we see Jesus in this incredible presence there with this heart telling us who is there, this incredible sacred heart of Jesus in front of us, telling us, bring that aching heart of yours, that dying heart of yours, and bring it right here to the center of my heart, right there. Like when we look at Jesus there, we see exactly the gate. He's calling us, bring this aching human heart and put it there. Let it palpitate with the sacred heart. And at that moment, we see a baby Jesus. What's happening with us? When we are born in this flesh, this baby that is growing is a happy baby originally. And he grows up. And then what happened? He becomes old. And it's painful because the soul don't age, but the body does. So the confusion of the soul seeing an aging body, and not only an aging body, but a body that is encased in sin. And this baby starts to be a sad baby. And then comes the baby Jesus and gives us this strength through this incredible spirituality. Questions I ask before, only to be answered through the Sacred Heart of Jesus when he explained to me somehow what baby Jesus meant, because I didn't realize what that meant. I couldn't relate to the baby Jesus. I could only relate to Jesus the adult. And I was always asking myself, how come people are so devoted to the baby Jesus? And I can't relate to, I see a beautiful baby Jesus, but I don't know how this works, how this devotion works. How do I tune in with the baby Jesus? And then I realized something, the Lord put something in my heart that was incredible, that made me cry. And this is that when we are hurt, we have this baby hurt in us, and we are getting closer to Jesus, one of the first steps that we do to walk to Jesus is to go to the baby Jesus, that is the holy baby, the baby that is really healed, the baby that is sane, the baby that is pure, the baby that is perfect and divine. And we take this hurt baby of us and put it at the feet of the baby Jesus and tell the baby Jesus to heal this baby of us that has been hurt and that is aging. And we know in our heart, in our souls knows that we are not aging really, because the soul doesn't age, but this body deceives us. And we start thinking that we are aging, and we are not. We are not aging. We are just releasing sin away from us. Because the more this body ages, the closer we get to the realization, the full realization of love, because we're going to be free from sin as we lose this body. But the question is, are we really ready to release this body? Because to be ready to release this body is to have understood what victim is, what suffering is. And it all comes down to that, everything. To realize what this body means is to realize suffering. To realize what flesh is to realize sin. To realize what the cross is to realize the death of this sin and the realization of suffering, the perfect realization of suffering. Then we understand the meaning of the purification through this body of our spirit to go and embrace ourselves eternally with the Lord. And realizing that, then we find an incredible hard reality, which is to really, really know that this world is our enemy. And then we will say, well, what should we do then? We're surrounded by the enemy. We are in a body that is sin, and the world is the enemy, and we are here. What do we do? And this is horrifying when we take it literally, and when we take it just intellectually. That's not to be understood, and people don't want to take this. This is an awful reality to talk like this. But we know Christ gave us the answer and the wisdom to know what he meant by that. And why did he show us the world as an enemy? Why did he show us this flesh as sin And why did he show us the devil as our enemy? Because he's showing us the path, the way, and he's showing us the cross. And he said, he who takes the cross and follow me finds eternal life. Then we have to understand, what is he showing? He's not showing an incredible, joyful life in this world, full of all kind of abundance and full of all kind of realizations of happiness and joy here, because that's not what Jesus came to show us. And if you read the scriptures, he tells us, I'm a sign of contradiction. I didn't come here to give you peace. I am a sign of contradiction. I'm going to be planted in the middle of all of you, and fire is going to go against son against father. And when you read that, you say, what is this? I mean, what is he talking about? Didn't he come to give us peace? Well, when we read between the lines, which is reading in the spirit, and we get away from this mind, this dead mind, because this rational mind is the most horrible separation of God if we make it work for us and not for the Lord. Because when it works for us, it works only against us, not for us. Because when we try to understand the mysteries of God, then we are separating ourselves from God and separating ourselves from suffering and from pain. And then therefore separating ourselves from salvation. Because our mind wants to get us away from suffering, away from pain. Anything that is uncomfortable, we run away from that. And we try to find a way to make it comfortable. We try to make the way that people won't hurt us. We try to be around people that's not going to do anything to us. We try to be around people that are not too difficult to handle. We try to stay away from everything that is difficult to do. We try to find the easy way. And we try to be as comfortable as we can and not to do any effort to do anything that get us to suffer. And we are afraid of suffering. And people every day, they wake up with, they presenting that something bad is going to happen because they are afraid to suffer. So every time they feel that something might go wrong somewhere somehow, and they feel strange because I think something is wrong somewhere. And when someone calls and gives them a bad news about something, they feel good because they say, I knew something bad was happening. It's like bad news are good news for them, for people sometimes, because they are trying to avoid pain. So when pain comes, they say, I knew something was wrong. But what it is that we are running away from pain and running away from suffering. And that's why when suffering comes up, it's a confirmation of what we're running away from. We're saying, you see, I knew there was suffering there. That's why I didn't want to deal with that. That person is always bringing me bad luck, bad things. Every time they come around, everything goes wrong. And blaming everybody else, blaming the kids, blaming the parents, blaming the neighbor, blaming the job, blaming the boss, blaming everybody, the government, the country, society, the world, the church, everybody. Because we're running away from suffering. We don't want to be victim souls. When we live in a place like this that is so blessed by God and is giving so much abundance and is giving comfort, it's a blessing. It's not a damnation, it's a blessing. But only if we take that blessing to build us into understanding suffering. Because what good does it do if we have a comfortable pillow and a very good mattress when our soul is not comfortable? And we're not sleeping well in the spirit. What good does it do? What good does it do when we have an incredible, comfortable car if our heart is not driving well? It's not that we are not going to accept what God gives us, because the Lord is giving us a lot of things that we enjoy, that we have to use them as instruments. There's nothing wrong with having abundance. There's nothing wrong with having a beautiful car, a beautiful house, money in the bank, and have this incredible abundance that the Lord is giving us. Why not? We can have that. The Lord wants us to have it. The thing is this separating us from Jesus? Is this separating us from salvation? Because we are so comfortable, then we don't want pain, and we don't want suffering, and we want to stay away from everyone that gives us any trouble. Anyone. Because we are so comfortable there. So it makes sure no one comes in and no one calls us and nothing happens around us that is going to make us suffer, that is going to get us confused or probably change our schedules of the day.
There he comes. Now my life is gonna be changed. Because every time he comes, everything changes. It's like unpredictable. Things happen. And we always trying to avoid that. So the call, when we really think about what God is telling us, we know that the God is telling us, don't fight against what you don't know, because then it's going to catch you up. Because you only have to fight against what is attacking you, but not against what you don't know. When you're trying to avoid suffering by keeping everything away that you think is going to make you suffering, what you're avoiding is salvation. Because in that suffering is the key to salvation. And maybe that person that is going to make you suffer is the one that is going to heal you. And the one, our enemies are our best friends. And think about this. Someone that comes and tells you just like it is, you call your enemy, right? Because he comes and tells you everything, right in your face. And that person becomes your enemy because he tells you the truth. Then that's usually the case in our human daily life. If someone dares to come in front of you and tell you everything just like it is, you probably don't talk to that person anymore for the rest of your life because that person told you the truth. And you try to avoid that. And that person is not a good person. And usually enemies are the ones that tell us those things and tell everybody else too about us. And we don't know that when we look at life from God's point, from God's eyes and from the Sacred Heart towards us, when we look at, if we stand right there in Jesus' body, right there where he is standing, we stand there for a second and look at us from there, we're going to see that what we're doing is we're trying to escape from taking that Sacred Heart of Jesus, because we know it is very painful. Because Jesus represents pain and suffering. And when we see Jesus, we see always his wounds. And we see the cross. And we see this incredible thing that happened to him. And we ask ourselves, why? So, well, he is God. He was able to take this and let this happen to him. I'm not God. I'm not going to be able to do that. And that is where we mistake. Because if one thing Jesus taught us through this passion was that he became a man in order to teach us how to be one. So if he wanted just to be present as God, he didn't need a human body. He would have come just like that, like God, and say, here, I am Jesus, and I'm going to teach you. That's it. He could do that. But he took a human body. So everything that happened to that body, he wants to happen to us too. And not necessarily today, in the world that we live in, we're going to have to be in a cross, because that's not the case today. But the cross had to be in us in many different ways, because each one of us, when we understand the mystery of the cross, then we know what kind of cross we are carrying. And we all know, each one of us here tonight know the crosses that we're carrying. We know. And every time we try to put the cross away and reject it, we get a heavier one. Because so many people is married, and they can't wait for the opportunity to stay away from marriage, or maybe divorce, even sometimes divorce, because they think they want to find something better. And what is happening? They find something worse. Because you cannot turn down the cross that you picked, because we all picked our own cross. We just given the freedom to do it, but we have to carry one, each one of us. Is the question is, do you know the one you picked? And do you know how heavy it is? Because usually, what it is the devil always trying to put us down and trying to destroy us, try to make sure we get the heaviest cross. And what he does with that is he saves us, you know? So he works always for God. But if we realize Jesus in the middle of picking up the cross, because a lot of people get lost and then reject the cross and throw it away and then run. But every time that you can hide from the cross, there's no way. You can run, but you know you can't hide from the cross, because the cross is in you. It's in you. So there's no way you can run away from the cross. It gets heavier as you run, heavier. But when you understand the cross you picked from day one, because as we grow and as we understand Christ, and when we start realizing that we are Christians,
Because one thing is being baptized, one thing is being a Catholic like I was for all the years that I was and I didn't practice and I rejected and turned down the sacraments and Jesus and everything. That's something else, you know, that's being with the devil. One thing is to be a Christian, but another thing is to understand what is a Christian, what a Christian is. And a Christian is the cross. Christian is cross. So being a Christian is being in the cross. It's crucifixion. Is purification, is redemption through pain, through suffering, redemption through the cross. So there comes the opportunity. We are served on a silver plate, this opportunity. We're talking about the victim souls. We see stamps where they show you the virgin for the aborted child, you know, the aborted kids. And you see this opportunity of adopting a child, and you all read this, I hope. And we see all these opportunities that the Lord is serving us, Christians, today. Because it's the incredible need for reparation. We are sitting here in Canada, and we're talking about no vocations. We're talking about closing churches. We're talking about people coming to Sunday Mass, but that's it. And then we're talking about hundreds and hundreds and thousands of Catholics that don't practice, and they are here. The church is just asleep. And what do we have to do? We are called to be victim souls in order to call back our people to the church, to call back the soldiers to the battle. And each one of us can do that by joining these opportunities the Lord is serving to us, of adopting a child so it doesn't be aborted, of being a victim soul and joining these incredible presentations of reparation that the Lord gives us through all these spiritualities. This is a blessing, an absolute blessing. And I think tonight, well, if anything, we are being blessed because the Lord is always talking to us in a very simple language. Nothing that comes from God is complicated because God is a simple word, means love. And how do we get to love? We have to understand suffering. And how do we know what suffering is? We have to realize Jesus. And what is Jesus? Jesus is a God that became a man. And being a man taught us how to be a man, how to be a human. A human that can become an angel, a saint. Because by him coming and touching this body, what he did, he picked us up and gave us the way back into sainthood and gave us home, eternal home. So let ourselves go into this cross, go into this sacred heart. Let's walk in there and feel the cross and give the Lord every single instant of our life that is against our expectations, everything that is difficult, everything that we don't want, every little thing, even food, even someone talking, even someone calling you, even a thought that comes to your mind, anything that comes to you that you don't want, that is the opportunity to repair. That is the opportunity to accept the cross and be there, crucified with Jesus, and say, Lord, I hate what is going on, but I'm going to give it to you. This is yours, and this is yours, and this is yours, and this is yours. And you continually do this, and you start doing this, and you're going to see how you're going to grow, because Jesus is going to grow in you, and it's going to be so strong that you're going to notice how weak the devil starts to get. And I tell you, I noticed something in my personal relationship with the Lord that I want to share with you. And it is that the more I have cleansed through the grace of the Lord, because without Him we can't clean anything. There's no way. On our own we cannot do it. But just because the Lord gave me the opportunity to clean a lot of mess from my life, I noticed that the devil, yesterday I was sitting at a church, St. Joseph's Church in Windsor, waiting to give a talk to the Spanish community. And I was by myself praying to the Lord in front of the tabernacle, and I was just there, and all of a sudden I got this horrible thought, and something horrible came from my past that had to do with my sexuality, And I was there, and it took me by surprise because it got to me, and I felt it, I lived it, I went through that, and then I realized in a very incredible way that it was Satan present there that brought me that. And it was so incredible because behind what I lived and what Satan brought, I was by myself, safe from that. And I had like a smile in me when I felt the angel come and take that away as soon as they knew I realized what was happening. So when I caught up, when I arrested the devil, my angel shoot him away, right away. And I felt the battle when my angel told him, away you go. And then you notice how weak he gets, because that is so obvious already that he was there. It was so obvious. But only because that area I've been cleaning very strongly. You know, every time something like that comes to me, I say, uh-huh, you are here. Now we're going to talk. You're going to leave. And you're not going to come back. And this and the other. And I keep on doing it. And every area of your life has to be worked like that. And I know it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. But you know, God willing, we will have enough time in the flesh in order to clean enough, so we don't have to spend much time in purgatory, because this is what we have to do. The more we clean this up, the more we clean purgatory. So we diminish time in purgatory as we are cleaning up ourselves. Every time Satan brings us, I'm sure that each one of you here present has been through this. That right at the moment when you're going to take communion, something comes to your mind that is nasty. That is something that has nothing to do with what you're doing at the moment. That is completely uncalled for. I don't know if I'm the only one, but I'm sure I'm not the only one. It's like the most amazing thing. And if we learn to detect that, then we learn to detect Satan. And then he starts getting really upset because he tries to, you know, I notice that at times he knows that he's going to be discovered, so he doesn't bring anything. And I feel like, oh my God, I've been almost a week that I haven't had any of these things coming. So I started to look around what he's doing. And sure enough, what he's doing, he's working it out through people, coming to me through other people. You see, they're bringing me things around through other people. And I can see the work that he's doing. And it's not that we have to be paranoid and always being looking for the devil everywhere, because that's not what we're called to do. We are called just to be aware of the devil, but not to be attentive to the devil full time, because then we're going to be living for him. And that's what we're not going to do. We're not going to do that. But what we're going to do is being safe in Jesus' hands. Being safe in the Sacred Heart of Jesus means having discernment. And means that we are with these weapons, this Eucharist that we take, that gives us the bread and the strength to be in this holy company, that keeps us away from evil. And if evil comes, when we are with this presence of the Lord, we're going to see it. It's like when we are just take a shower and we are so clean and we have white clothes on and something is splitting out there, there is mud there, cars are going really fast, the first thing you do is stay away from there, because the next thing you know, you're going to get dirty, right? Things are there and you see mud and dirt everywhere. You stay away, you white clothes, you just shower, you walk away from that, because it's possible that you get dirty. And that is the sensation you have when you are with Christ, when you have Jesus in your heart. You are clean. And then when you see something that is not exactly of Jesus, and it's dirt and it's mud, and it's something you don't want to come to your soul, you know that you have to step away from that. Because if you stay close to that, your clothes is going to get really dirty. And that is what happens all the time when we are not attentive to the presence of mud, the presence of dirt. Because we have to be aware of that. And we all always see it, because God gave us the wisdom to see it. And the more we are with the Lord, the more we know the dark, the more we see the devil, the more we see evil everywhere, and the easier it is to walk through. Because when you know evil, and you are aware of evil, and you know that you are safe, and you have the weapons with you, you just walk through. And you walk firmly and lovingly and surely and completely self-assured that you are protected and there's nothing to worry about. Because even if the mud is blowing all over the place, when you are walking with the Lord and you're walking firmly to your destination, there's no mud that can get to you. None. Only if you stand in there expecting to be clean, but you are just standing on the mud, that's when you get dirty. Because the, you know, the apostles say in so many ways in the scriptures, and this can get confusing if you take it literally. They say you should not be with people that are in deadly sin. Don't even touch their clothes. You know, sometimes we read this. I'm sure you have read this. This is in some of the epistles and in many letters of the apostles, that you can read that in different places. You say, but then we have to be aware of this. We can't fail to charity. That doesn't mean we have to isolate ourselves from sinners, because we are all sinners. And we are all, you know, called to probably fall in deadly sin one day, God forbid, but it's possible. So we are not called to just discriminate people that are sinners or are in deadly sin. But we are to be aware, this person is in deadly sin. This person is standing in the devil's territory. Therefore, first of all, I cannot fully trust this person, because maybe the devil is going to talk to that person. I cannot completely 100% guarantee that everything that is happening around that person is 100% solid, because many things can happen. Anything can happen with somebody that is living a deadly sin, that is living in sin. You know, there's so many things going on. So when you know this and you are aware, you're not discriminating a person. You are aware of sin, aware of the devil, aware of the presence of evil around that person. That person is not evil, and that person is not sin. It's the devil that is sin and the devil that is evil. It's a creature that we're talking about, and that creature is the one we pray for, and we ask the Lord to protect that creature, to convert it, because the apostles say very clearly that we cannot pray for our brother's deadly sins. We cannot do that. We cannot tell the Lord, Lord, forgive the adultery of my brother. My brother is an adulterer. We can't say that, because we cannot pray for deadly sin. We can pray the Lord to convert them, to call them to Him, to change them, you know, but not to deal with their sins and ask the Lord to forgive what they're doing. Because each one is responsible for the soul. And this is very clear. St. John explains this very clear. You know, when they speak about, and St. Paul too, they talk about what the relationship between us and God is direct, is unique. And we cannot do anything about our brother's sins. We can, the only thing we can do is we pray for our brother's conversion. We pray for our brother's salvation. But we can't pray for the sins. There's nothing we can do about it. We can pray for the souls in purgatory for what they are purgating, because they can't repair any longer. So they don't have a flesh. And they are our church of purgatory. Therefore, we are united in prayer. But we can't pray for another human being that has the flesh, to purify, to repair, and it's not doing it. It's doing it worse. It's just getting it even worse than it is. So we are the result of original sin, and the result on top of that of our personal sin. Then everything that we have good in us is God. So how much God do we have? That is the question. How much of God do we have? And so that's how good we are. In the presence of God in us, is the only thing good that we have. So we have to realize how close to God are we in order to find out how good we are. Because if we are humble and real, as far as knowing what God means and what the relationship with the Spirit is, then we understand that we have to realize how much of Jesus is growing in us. And then the rest that is not there of Jesus and is the presence of the devil is the one we're fighting to get out of ourselves. And it's easy if we understand it that way. Because if we are humble enough and we recognize that probably Jesus is not that large in us, then we are in a good situation, we're in a good position because we are humble. And then we say, okay, I'm going to give more and more space to the Lord in me. I'm going to allow the Lord to grow to the point where one day He's going to be looking through my eyes. And He's going to be the one guiding, doing everything with me. And that is what we call to do as victim souls. If we are understanding suffering and the cross. Everything ends and begins in the cross. So we are called to give everything to the Lord and put it in the cross. Every time we wake up, remember Calvary. Remember the Lord and see the cross. And going to the cross and say, Lord, I am here and I'm going to walk this day in the cross with you. So everything that happens in your life, remember the Lord forgiving everyone for what they did because they do not know what they were doing, and excusing them on top of that, apologizing them to the Lord, just excusing their actions. That's what the Lord did in the cross. So he told the Father, forgive them because they don't know what they do, and also was like excusing them, excusing us. And that's what we are called to do. We are called to excuse everyone of our enemies. We are called to excuse everything that happens around. Lord, I don't know, this is bad, I know this is bad, but just forgive them, and you have to understand it. They are in pain, they don't know what they're doing, they are so away from you, and you start going like this, and then you start acting like Christ, because that is the call. The call is to act like him, be in the cross, and understand the Sacred Heart of Jesus. Because it's not difficult to sit by the tabernacle and visit the Blessed Sacrament and just let your heart be one with the heart of Jesus. You're going to end up feeling the heartbeat of the Lord in your chest, and you're going to tune in with that. And one day you're going to walk around with that heartbeat permanent with you. And we are calling the Lord today not only to forgive us, but to forgive our enemies. Because in order to start a victim soul road path, we have to forgive first. If we don't forgive, pain and suffering won't do anything. Because if we don't forgive, if we are suffering and offering to the Lord suffering, but we still haven't forgave someone throughout our life, we're not doing anything. Nothing is worth anything. We have to forgive everyone. Every one of our enemies. Everyone that ever hurt us. We have to forgive. Truly forgive. And that moment we start being a victim soul. Because then we are loving for real. And then we are in the cross. So we are asking the Lord tonight to give us that. To give us, not only to forgive us, but to teach us to forgive. And to give us the opportunity to be pure of heart. And to tune in our hearts with His Sacred Heart. We ask Our Lady to receive us in her Immaculate Heart. And to give us the opportunity not only to be her children that are protected and led to the heart of the Lord, to the Sacred Heart, but also to be the army of the Lady, that army of the Lady. Today, this army that is called upon the battle, we have to be present for the battle. And we are called upon this battle today. So we thank the Lord for this opportunity of tonight. And we hope that we keep on forgiving and understanding pain so that we can really heal not only ourselves, but this world that is so in so much pain and darkness. Amen. Thank you.